This is Legacy Battle. Make sure you hit that subscribe button on YouTube, iHeartRadio, Apple, Amazon Music. I'm Michael Adams, creator of Legacy Battle. My panelists tonight from the Gridiron Battle Zone, Brian King. From Steelers Nation South, Rollo Cawthon. From the Walker Report, we got Bradley Walker. Our special guest tonight, he's hockey royalty, a legend internationally. He's a member of, check this out, the Manitoba Hockey Hall of Fame, the International Ice Hockey Hall of Fame, the Swedish Hockey Hall of Fame, the World Hockey Association Hall of Fame. He's a Bill Masterton Trophy winner, NHL All Star, 50 goals in the 50 games club. He was GM of Team Sweden in 2000. And I'd give you some more information on him, but I have to actually represent him later on in this debate. So I'm going to hold off the rest. But we got the great Anders Hedberg here. Anders, thank you for coming on.
Terrific. Thanks for letting me on.
Yeah, this is going to be fun. Tonight's debate is going to be the top five European hockey players, forwards of all time. As always, afterwards, we'll have a Q&A about Mr. Hedberg's career here. But we're going to start out tonight with Brian and Yari Curry.
All right, Yari Curry, right winger, 6 foot, even, 194 pounds, born in Helsinki, Finland. In 1980 to 1988, he was in the NHL 17 seasons, mostly with the Oilers, also some time with the Kings, a couple other teams after that. Now, there's a narrative that follows this guy that says he was only great because of Wayne Gretzky. But I'm here to say this is far from the truth. This is sort of a casual fan take, I think. The real ones know that the Oilers were really struggling despite having Gretzky on their roster early on. And it was when they acquired Curry that things really took off in Edmonton, leading to the dynasty. Curry was Wayne's right-hand man. They developed a great chemistry. Most of the time, Wayne started it. Curry finished it. With his great instincts to get open in the offensive zone and deadly accurate shot. In a span of 13 years, Curry scored 30-plus goals in a season 11 times. He topped 40 in 7 consecutive seasons. He led the NHL with 68 goals in the 85-86 season, and he had the 8th highest total in NHL history with 71 goals in the 84-85 season. Yet he was not strictly a goal scorer. Curry could back check and play defense as well as any forward in the league. Mark Messier once said that Curry should have won the Selke Trophy at least once during his career. He was top five. He was a top five finalist 4 times. As far as the entirety of his career, Curry is 20th all time in goals, 33rd in assists, 23rd in points, and only Gretzky, Messier, Yzerman, and Lemieux scored more times shorthanded than Yari Curry. In 2001, he became the first native of Finland inducted into the Hockey Hall of Fame. So he made the great one better, but also he was great in his own right. Yari Curry.
So Anders, as Brian said, the narrative around Yari Curry is if he didn't have Gretzky, he wouldn't have the numbers. So I totally disagree with that, but is he overshadowed because he played with Gretzky?
Not at all. I think hockey is a team sport, and the complement of Gretzky's playmaking mind, Einstein of hockey, but Wayne certainly wasn't very strong in his own end. And the combination then of Yari's, Curry's intelligence on the ice. I mean, he covered areas. He, in his own end, he was absolutely perfect. And Wayne needed somebody like that. And with his shot and with his ability to find openings of Wayne's passing, you couldn't find a better combination of those two guys. And both of them, and we talk about Yari, very humble, no ego, adjusted to whatever surroundings, whatever line mates. Obviously, Wayne had all the headlines and Yari was in the shadow. You had Messier that had a much bigger ego. There was no conflicts whatsoever. Yari just produced and was a terrific, terrific teammate.
time and time again, he was winning Stanley Cups. You can't take that away from him. So,
and he was very important on that team. They had a few other important players too, but he was actually one of the 3, 4, 5 key members of winning the Stanley Cup in Edmonton.
Excellent.
And the others, obviously, was Grant Fuhr, Coffey, Messi, and Gretzky. And that's a pretty nice surrounding, I would say.
Yeah, you're going to win some games with those guys.
I think the chances is pretty good that you would win with those guys. Exactly.
Let's move on to the ageless wonder, Jaromir Jagr.
Might be here all day talking about Jagr, so...
Exactly. So, he's still playing,
so we might be here all day. But, you know, Jaromir Jagr was one of the first hockey players that I grew up watching because I'm from Pittsburgh and he broke in with the Penguins. So Jagr from Kladno, Czech Republic, is not probably the best European bred player ever, but he's probably one of the best hockey players ever, period. So this is going to be easy. He's going to be in the top five. But he started playing professionally at age 16 with the Czech national team, Pauli Kladno. And at 17, he was playing for the Czech national team in the World Championships. It was that performance in that Czech national team that he caught the eyes of the NHL scouts, and he was drafted 5th overall by the my Pittsburgh Penguins, your Pittsburgh Penguins. he was one of the first players that did not have to defect, one of the first Czechoslovakian players that didn't have to defect to play it to get into the NHL. But in his rookie season, he was 4th on the team in scoring. So coming into the league as a young guy, 19 years old, he was 4th on the team in scoring. He had a bunch of stars on that team, Mark Recchi, Mario Lemieux, just a bunch of stars, and he was 4th on the team in scoring. He had his first hat trick in 91, which is the first of 16. For somebody who played so long, he only had 16 hat tricks, but he is still one of the top scorers of all time. So that means he was consistent in his games when he played. He had 13 straight seasons of 100 plus points, including a career high in the 95-96 season. And with him, Lemieux, and Ron Francis, where they combined for 420 points in 95-96. That's crazy. he also set the record for right wingers and Europeans with 62 goals and 87 assists. He's the only European player in the top 15 in career points, and only him and Teemu Selanne, who we're going to discuss a little bit later, are in the top 20 in scoring. 10 times he had more than 90-plus points in a season. 12 times he had more than 25 goals. 18 times he had more than 25 goals in a season. He's first all-time in game-winning goals, so he came up clutch in big situations. He's on the 90-91 All-Rookie team. He's a 13-time All-Star. He's a 5-time Art Ross Trophy winner. He was the 99 Hart Trophy winner, 3-time Lester Pearson winner, and the 2016 Bill Masterton winner. And he's one of only 2 Czech players in the triple goal club. So this is a wrap for him. He's already just put him, let's debate the other 4 on the top 5.
So, Anders, is he one-on-one the scariest player we're talking tonight because of his one? He knows how to use his weight. He's got a big back rear end, let's put it like that, so he can keep people off the puck. But his one-on-one stick skills are incredible, outstanding. I've never seen anything like it, and I'm someone who grew up watching Mario. So your thoughts on Jagr?
I saw him, I didn't know he was 17. I saw him as an 18 at the World Championship in Stockholm, here in Stockholm, 89. He was 17 or 18 at the time. I was actually sitting with the manager of Pittsburgh Penguins at the time, Craig Patrick, that I had worked for and was trying to recruit me to Pittsburgh at the time. I was working in the front office. And were Craig happy what he saw? His 18-year-old, and he was drafted at the time, I think. He was very happy. Obviously, we all could see this guy is going to be not only a good player, he's going to be a key player. He's going to be a franchise player. And that's exactly what he became. Even if I found him being in the shadow of Lemieux in Pittsburgh. In terms of points, I think he produced the most a year in New York, when he was in New York. But here is a player that had, first of all, so strong on his skates. Was he the fastest? No, he wasn't the fastest. But he was so strong on the puck, you couldn't take away the puck. And people were just bouncing off his big behind, even more so when he became a little older and played a little differently than when he was really young. But here is a player still playing. I don't know why. He can't be playing because of money. Yeah, I'm sure he's filthy rich. He owns the club just because he loves the game, loves to play, loves to be in the dressing room. And that's the way the feeling I have when I see Jagr. God, yes, I love the game, and I know that he loves it too.
He's never going to get in the Hall of Fame because he's never going to retire.
Exactly. He played with Ron Francis, that sits on the selection committee of the Hockey Hall of Fame as well as I do. And I think he has a pretty good chance but he has to hang up his skates 3 years before he can be inducted. So I would think, I can't say more than that, but I think he has a pretty good chance.
All right, let's move on to Peter Forsberg.
Peter Forsberg, drafted 6th overall by the Philadelphia Flyers in 1991. He is from where our guest is from, the lovely country of Sweden.
Played from my hometown.
There we go.
We're from the same hometown, yes.
Well, I was going to – I don't know how to pronounce that word, so I wasn't even going to try and butcher that.
I can pronounce it for you. In English, it's Örnsköldsvik, and yeah. In Swedish, it's Örnsköldsvik.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. I didn't even want to try to even attempt to say that word. I didn't want to butcher it.
But, I know.
Forsberg played, of course, with the Quebec Nordiques before they became the Colorado Avalanche. He was part of 2 Stanley Cups with the Avalanche. He, like Jagr, you know, I think played in the shadow of Joe Sakic. He was the captain. You know, that was the straw that stirred the drink for the Avalanche. But he did win an Art Ross Trophy. He's won a Hart Memorial Trophy, a Calder Memorial Trophy when he was with the Nordiques before they transferred to Colorado. He's in a Hockey Hall of Fame. 3-time All Star, and you know the cool thing about him is wherever he went, he wore the number 21. So I'm just gonna leave it at that.
So with Forsberg, a lot of people forget he's drafted by the Philadelphia Flyers, and the 3rd biggest trade in hockey history, as they call it. Eric Lindros refuses to play for Quebec, and the trade happens, and Quebec turns into Colorado and wins a couple Stanley Cups. Philly is still waiting since 1970-whatever to win a cup. So who knows what might have happened had that trade not gone down. But, Anders, your thoughts on Forsberg, of all the players we're talking about tonight, he was the guy that was out there against the team's other best players. Very strong defensive forward and good at faceoffs.
He wasn't the greatest skater of everyone, not at all. But in many ways, he was very similar to Jagr, incredibly strong on his skates. Protected a puck extremely, extremely well. And obviously, he saw the ice. I mean, he wasn't Gretzky, but he was somewhere in that direction, meaning he knew where everybody else was on the ice. And he competed. He competed incredibly good. He competed better than 99% of the players in the NHL, meaning a very slim. If you're competing as hard as Peter did, and he competed also physically, so, and he was a mean sucker on the ice. But obviously, he made players around him better. He was able to produce when the team really needed a production. And he's one of those players that as a team member or as a team, you love to play with him. Have him on the ice. Put him on the ice. I don't care. He was open always available to be open for passes from the defenseman or other his teammates. And if you skated and put your stick down, you knew that you were going to get the puck from Peter Forsberg.
Excellent player. Unfortunately, injuries stalled his career. He had to leave a little early. He tried to come back. You think he played one or two games and he had to retire again because of injuries. But
he had lots of injury, which was a huge problem both for Peter, but also for his teams, because you really didn't know if it's going to be injured or if it's going to play, which a good player, he consumed quite a bit of money on your pay scale and the money you were able to maximum payroll, which was an issue during his last half of his career in many ways.
Yeah. Well, let's go back to Finland here. We're going to talk about Teemu Selänne, born in Finland, as I just stated, but played from 1992 to 2014. So a very, very long career. Spent it with the Jets, Sharks, Avalanche, the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim, and then later the Anaheim Ducks. He is currently 16th all-time in NHL history with points with 14,057. He is 12th in goals with 684, and that's better than everyone we're talking about tonight except for that guy named Jagr. He did win Rookie of the Year, and his Rookie of the Year, he took the league by storm. He put in 76 goals as a rookie, which tied him for the league lead with Alexander Mogilny at the time. But he did have more even strength goals than Mogilny. Mogilny's extras came on the power play. So, you know, my opinion, it's a little harder to score even strength there. But 10-time All-Star, Stanley Cup winner, Maurice Richard and Bill Masterton winner, 4th all-time in power play goals, 5th in game winners. He's led Finland internationally to 6 bronze medals and 4 silver medals. He played internationally from juniors all the way until even like after he had retired. I think he still ended up playing at the Olympics after he retired there. So, but for a while, Teemu and his line mate, Paul Kariya, they were pretty much the most feared line in hockey there for a while out there in Anaheim. Once Lemieux retired the first time and Jagr was kind of left alone, then the best duo there was definitely Selänne and Kariya. So Anders, your thoughts on Teemu, It seems like the Europeans have the longevity thing down for sure. I give them credit for that. But what are your thoughts on Teemu Selänne?
Well, you had Paul Kariya and Teemu on your team. You better hurry up as a defenseman because that was speed. Both of those guys could fly. And Teemu actually was the best player in the 2014 Olympics in Sochi as a 34-year-old. And Finland didn't have a very good team. He was the best player. And his game, I mean, he came to Winnipeg, and I still have so many friends. We played 4 years in Winnipeg. It's 100 years ago, but I still have so many friends there. And this is only when the Jets sort of still in the NHL before they disappeared, went to Phoenix. And I was living at the time, I don't know if I was living in Stockholm or in Toronto, all my Winnipeg friends, they were just, were they enthusiastic. And in Winnipeg, hockey is religion. It's not an entertainment. It's not a fun thing a couple of days a week. They live and die hockey. And Teemu Selänne just took the city and Manitoba by storm the way he played with his speed, his enthusiasm, his smile, and flair of his game. And if you scored 76, And I know that he stayed a year or two longer in Finland because his lawyer was actually Don Baisley, a very good friend of mine. He's a lawyer out of Winnipeg. And Don and I have discussed so many times, it's better to arrive from Europe or from wherever you come, college, a little bit too late than too early. And Timo took that time to arrive exactly the right time. Winnipeg had a pretty good team, and he scored 76 goals. Good for him.
All right, let's go on to Matt Sundin.
All right, Matt Sundin, center. Big guy, 6'5", 240 pounds, born in Bromma, Sweden. He played from 1989 to 2009, so 18 seasons there. First overall pick of the draft by Quebec. I spent four seasons there, 13 seasons with the Leafs, and then a season with the Canucks. So as part of Team Sweden, he and his teammates were able to win three golds, two silvers, and two bronzes at the World Championships, and a gold in 2006 at Turin for the Winter Olympics. Sundin accumulated 94 points in 79 international games. So that's almost a 1.2 points per game average. So really, really good. During his NHL career, Sundin scored over 70 points in all but three of his seasons. And while with the Leafs, he led the team in scoring in all but 2 years. He was the team captain for 11 consecutive seasons. He was a big reason behind the success that that team had. Over his career, he was an 8-time All-Star. He had the most game-winning goals of the 03-04 season. He had the 12th most career in the NHL history. He is 24th in career goals with 564, 36th in career assists, 30th in career points, 21st in shorthanded goals, and 38th in power play goals. He had 8 hat tricks, and he scored on 5 penalty shots, so he could get the job done when the pressure was on. And this guy's leadership was on display regularly. In 2007, 2008, he was presented with the Mark Messier Award for Leadership. And, you know, Penguins fans will remember he had quite a nice playoff series against the Penguins in 1999. In game three alone, he was able to get 2 assists, a power play goal, and a game-winning goal. Big reason why they were able to take care of the Penguins in that series. You know, and when it came time to induct him into the Hall of Fame, he went in on the first ballot. So one of the best forwards of all time from Europe, Matt Sundin.
Saunders, Canadians fans, they look at a lot of things when it comes to hockey, specifically Stanley Cups. Sundin, as great as he was, never got the Toronto Maple Leafs over that hump into the Stanley Cup Finals. And, you know, over here, that kind of it hurts his legacy a little bit. I'm not going to lie about it. It does. It's one of the, like, glaring omissions from his resume. But what are your thoughts on Mr. Sundin?
I was part of the I was scouting in Europe for Toronto. And Cliff Fletcher was the manager in Toronto. And the discussions was going on with Quebec between Cliff and the Nordiques. And I was working on the background on Matt's parents, siblings, girlfriends, lifestyle, and whatever it was, it came with a big smile on people's face. This guy can play. He's a wonderful human being. If you can get him to Toronto, he will be your captain for the next 10 or 15 years, exactly what he became. Yeah. Did Toronto have a very good team? Me and my Mats was there. No, they did not have a very good team. This is Toronto. There's no patience in the city. If they lose twice, there has to be a trade. Matt survived as their leader, as their captain, were able to communicate with everybody in hockey. So don't blame Matt for not winning the Stanley Cup, which I agree. That is, I mean, you have to win somewhere along the line. and Mats won more than anybody else and was always the captain for the Swedish Nationals almost for 15 years. And any time he showed up on the Swedish National, he was the national leader, no question. You had Lidström, you had Forsberg, you had Näslund, you had wherever, whoever. Mats was the captain, and he was leading Sweden actually in very many cases to very good, not only silver or bronze, actually the gold, as he did in the Olympics, for example, in Turin. So Mats Sundin, and he had an I think he scored more goals on his back end than he scored on his forehand, because he was absolutely deadly when he came in on a defenseman or a goaltender. He lifted, he had that long, long, long reach and lifted that back and up in the top corner and scored, did I say half? Probably not, but say a third of his goals on his back end. What a player, what a personality, what a leader.
Let's go Peter Stastny.
Peter Stastny, one of the most important people that we're going to discuss tonight as far as the NHL. Peter was from Bratislava, Slovakia, and he broke out with his brothers Anton and Marian as part of the Czech national team in the 1980 Olympics. Between the three, they combined for 16 goals and 34 points in 6 games at the Olympics. But shortly after the Olympics, Anton and Peter, along with Peter's wife, decided they were going to defect from Slovakia, Czechoslovakia. And so they contacted some of the representatives from the Quebec Nordiques who had flown out, and they secretly got on one of the planes and flew out to be part of the Quebec Nordiques. But they quickly took the lead by storm, both Anton and Peter. Peter had scored 109 points and 39 goals in his first season in the NHL. At the time, it was the first time a player had scored more than 100 plus points in their rookie season in the NHL. Peter and Anton, they also shared quite a moment where they both scored 8 points in the game against the Washington Capitals. But the following year, their brother Marian came out as part of the Quebec Nordiques, and they formed one of the best lines in the NHL for 5 or 6 seasons. The first season that Marian was there, Peter had his best season with 139 points and 47 goals. Over the next 5 seasons with his brothers, he averaged 118 points and 42 goals per season. In 9 of his 16 seasons, he had 25 plus goals in those seasons. Then he was traded to the Devils at the age of 33, where he still averaged, he was still a productive scorer. He averaged almost 20 goals as a 33 to 36 year old player. He retired after the 95-96 season with the Blues, and he retired as the 5th highest scoring ever among European players. One of the things that stands out to me is that he got his start in the league at the age of 24, when most players start between the ages of 18, 19, 20 years old. So he had almost 6 seasons where he was behind the 8-ball. So he only finished with 450 goals, but his 1.26 points per game is still the highest ever for a European bred player. He's won the 80-81 Calder Trophy, and of the 1980s, he was the 2nd highest leading scorer in the league behind the one great Wayne Gretzky. And why he should be on this list, him and his brother's defection opened the floodgates for a lot of Czechoslovakian and Russian players to come play in the NHL. And the fact that he spoke 6 languages, he helped acclimate a lot of those players, adjust to life in the United States and playing with some of their clubs. So that's why he should be on the list's top 5.
So rumor has it in 1984 that all 3 Stastny brothers were offered to the Pittsburgh Penguins for the first round draft pick, first pick overall, which ended up being Mario Lemieux, and Pittsburgh turned it down. So there's a little story about the Stastnys. So Anders, your thoughts on Peter? Let's talk about the defecting. Like, what was the process for something like that to even occur back then? I mean, we don't see it now, but you know, what's going through a player's mind when something like that's happening, and your thoughts on him as a player?
Well, let's start with the possibility of Europeans coming to North America during the 70s or 80s. There was no Russians arriving. They were not allowed, and they had no chance of defecting. The consequences for their families, they didn't really know. So the first Russian that defected was McGillney, 1989, at the World Championship here in Stockholm. After that, Larionovs and the Fetisovs were allowed. But that's also the breakup of the communist system and the Soviet Union, 89, 90, 91. The first one that really defected, Stasny's defected, but kind of from a softer regime in Czechoslovakia than in Russia. And but the one that really defected, that really had, and he had no idea of the consequences of his family, was Václav Nenomansky. And he defected in 1974. That was a brave, he was brave. He took a huge risk and he managed, still lives in the United States actually, same as Peter does. But 84 or 85, and at the time they were a little older, they were mature. They were kind of given the okay, not okay, but allowed to leave for Quebec in a, when the political situation had softened in Europe in many ways. The Swedes or the Finns, hey, we live in a democratic community, society. We could do anything we wanted to from very early states. That's why Tomer Bergman was the first European that went to North America and Detroit Red Wings, 1972. But the Stasnys then arriving, they played in Quebec. They came together as a family almost. They played together. Peter was the star of the Stasny brothers. He had the personality, he had the skills, he had all the intangibles to become a really, really good player. And his NHL stats, which are maybe the best of them all, 1.27 points per game, but also because he arrived as a 25-year-old. So his prime was actually in North America. He's actually not as a young, really young, where you're too young to really produce. He really played his prime in Quebec and was an absolutely fabulous player. He could score, he could check, he could skate, he could think, he was strong. I don't know where the weakness was. Nowhere.
Let's go to Stan Mikita.
Stan Mikita, center, Chicago Blackhawks, played his entire career in a Blackhawk uniform from the Slovak Republic. Again, I don't know how I did this, but I picked another player that wore the number 21. I just looked that up as I was just sitting here. He, of course, is a Hockey Hall of Famer. Won one Stanley Cup with the Chicago Blackhawks, 1961. He had 11 points in 12 games. He played almost 1,400 games, scoring 541 goals. He was one of the players, I guess, at a time that played with a crooked stick. That was one of the cool things about him. I guess I just found out from my roommate, who's a huge NHL fan, that one of his superstitions was he had to smoke between every period. It was a superstition of his. I don't know why that. And also what I find cool about him is, remember, in Wayne's World, there was a Stan Mikita donuts. I mean, you that's can't right. about that. That was cool about him, but that's Stan Mikita right there.
So he, Anders, he played with the Golden Brett there, Brett. Or
Bobby. No. He played Bob with Hall. The Golden Hall. Yes. Bobby Hall. Brett.
Bobby Hall.
Hey, don't compare Brett and Bobby, because Brett was terrific and he was fabulous, but Dad Bobby Hall was a different level than Brett. And Bobby played with Mikita in Chicago.
So quite the duo with them. And as Brad mentioned, they're basically responsible for the banana blade, the curved blade. They were at an advantage for a while there until the NHL figured out we got to have some sort of, you know, level that the puck's at least got to fit under it. But I know your argument against Mikita, so I'm going to let you make that. But what also did you think of him as a player?
Well, I really don't know. I might have played against him when he represented Canada at the 72 series. Team Canada came and played two games here in Stockholm. They have played four games against the Russians in Canada, played two exhibition or bigger ice type of games here in Stockholm, the Swedish Nationals, before they continue to Moscow. Actually, that's when I decided, Jesus, if these guys, the Canadians, if these are all superstars, I think I'm going to make a living out of this. I was 21 years old and I could skate with them. So Stan Mikita, that's the only time. And he basically was finished when Bobby left. We came to Winnipeg 74. Stan Mikita, I have very little memory of him as a player. I know him as a player, but not very well. And I don't think he's a European player. I think he basically grew up in Canada. So he was born in Czechoslovakia, but basically he immigrated or moved with his family, whatever, to Canada in a young age and must be considered a Canadian player.
That's a good argument against. Let's move on to our final player tonight, who we know was born in Europe and lived in Europe. It's Anders Hedberg. So,
oh no, wait. You have to have Niklas Lidström as part of the presentation. I mean,
well, we're doing forwards only, so Lidström.
Oh, forward. Okay, that's why Salming and Lidström. I couldn't figure that out. I couldn't. Okay, do Anders Hedberg. Fine.
That's right. There you go. Gotta have you on the list here. So played for Sweden 66 to 74. Then he came over to America at age 23, which is actually kind of old to start your career if you think about it.
I had to get my education in place. I wasn't gonna be making a living out of hockey.
Smart man. Went to the World Hockey Association, the Winnipeg Jets, was there from 74 to 78. Then he went to the Rangers from 78 to 85. So when we combine all his points in all his leagues, I got 958 career points. I'm pretty sure that's accurate. I think my math was right. So, but he's the only two-time Swedish Junior Player of the Year. So that's a nice little trophy case for him there. So I want to talk about the 76-77 season. These are Gretzky-like numbers that season. Only 68 games, 70 goals, 131 points. And of course, he was an all-star that year. That is fantastic. That's almost 2 points a game. Every year that he was in the World Hockey Association, he was in the all-star game. He won the Rookie of the Year there, the Lou Kaplan Trophy. He's got 13 career hat tricks. He's a great playoff performer, 109 points in 100 games. We all know in the playoffs, it's a different game. So if you can continue to have a point a game or a point above a game in the playoffs, that's outstanding. He's got two WHA championships, and he has the second highest plus minus in World Hockey Association history at plus 206. And he's first in goals per game in the World Hockey Association history. So add all that into also what I had said in the intro about all the Hall of Fames. He's also got he's got a silver medal. What is it? Three bronzes. I'm forgetting it at the moment, but he's got tons in his trophy case. I know it's hard to talk about yourself. I get that, but let's just go with kind of a question of what made you decide to, when you did come over, to go to the WHA instead of the NHL.
I was actually asked. First time I was by far the youngest player on the Swedish Nationals, playing at the World Championship in 1970. And somebody from Vancouver called me, Vancouver Canucks expansion team. I'd never been to North America, had no idea. I mean, we weren't able to follow NHL. We knew it was the professional league. And as I said earlier in the comment, I wasn't thinking of making hockey. You couldn't make a living out of hockey. I had to get a education, and my father was not interested in sports at all, but he said, you can play as much as you like, but you have to look after your schooling. So I had to finish my degree. So I have a teaching degree, and that's why I arrived 74. I had offers from 70 to 72, 73, belonged to Toronto at the time. But it was myself, Ulf Nilsson, and the captain of the Swedish Nationals. We decided to go to Winnipeg because one of the teachers at my university, he was here on a research project for hockey physiology. He was from Winnipeg, and he called the guys in Winnipeg, say, you have to come over. There is players here. They can play. So Ulf and I and Lars Erik, that became the captain in Winnipeg, we decided pretty well to go together to Winnipeg. At the time, Tommy Berman, as I said, was in Detroit already. He was the first that never played in minors, nothing, right into the team. And then Borje and Inge Hammerström went 73 to Toronto. I belonged to Toronto. I could have gone there. Actually, they were paying me more money in Toronto. But we had made up our mind. We're going to Winnipeg to find out what this is all about.
All right. Well, we got some shout-outs before we hit our vote. Guys that just missed the list, Marian Hossa, the Sundin Twins, Alfredson, Zetterberg, Naslin, Bondra, Gaborik, and Eliash. All very good players. Just missed our list tonight. Let's move into our vote, guys. You cannot vote for your own. Brad, who are you taking?
Matt Sundin.
Matt Sundin. All right. Wasn't expecting that one. All right. Brian.
I'll tell you what, I'm impressed with Solani. I mean, that what a goal scorer he was.
All right. I'm gonna take Jágr. I mean, gotta have Jágr. All right, Rollo.
NHL 98 cover. EA Sports, Peter Forsberg.
Peter Forsberg. Anders, you got your choice of Jari Kurri, Peter Stastny. We know you're not taking Makita. And yourself, of course.
Oh, God. Between Stastny and Kurri?
That's tough.
That is, it's almost impossible. But I have to say that I probably would take Stastny. Kurri won 4 Stanley Cups, but it was they had such a powerful team. I'll take Stastny. I have to take Stastny as an individual.
All right. So Legacy Battle's top 5 European forwards of all time: Timo Solani, Matt Sundin, Peter Stastny, Jaromir Jágr, Peter Forsberg. Nice job, guys. Let's move into our Q&A. Let's see. Rollo, you got the win tonight. You got both on. You got first question. Go ahead.
So, Anders, you grew up in a small town in Sweden. You wound up going to Winnipeg. And then you wound up going to the Big Apple. How was that transition going into an environment like New York City and playing at Madison Square Garden?
I had never been to New York. And my first... We became Ulf became free agent. I'm just picking free agent, first ever in the history of hockey, and we had offers from every NHL team at the time. It was 16, and we first New York, and I said to Ulf, and we had decided we could go together. I said, no, New York is too big for me. I can't manage. That's too big. And Ulf said, no, you're not. He was from Stockholm. We're going to New York because if you're going to make it big, you have to make it in New York. So we went to New York and we had a wonderful, Ulf was injured most of the time, unfortunately, but we had just a fabulous experience in the Big Apple.
Brad, then Brian.
Anders, I have to ask, I'm a huge Lightning fan. Can I get your opinion on Victor Hedman?
Well, here's another big boy from my hometown. Can you pronounce it? Örnsköldsvik.
Yeah. I'm not even going to attempt that.
I don't know. I don't know his father. I know Peter Forsberg's father and Marcus Nestor's parents. I know the players too, obviously. I don't know Hedman and I don't know his parents, but I know his brother, actually. And he comes from exactly the right background. I mean, they love the game. They've learned the game. They played it. They had their a skating sheet, a little rink beside where they grew up. That's where you become a player. And here is a 6'6", I think he is 6'6", today probably 220, and moves like a player that is 6'180 pounds, and an unbelievable reach. There is an aura around him. Don't come close to him because you can't get around him. It's impossible. And he can, obviously, it helps his production that he plays with who plays on the right side on the power play, and who plays on the left side on the power play. He just distributes, and then he's the safety guard. And sometimes they let him even shoot the puck, you know, or there's a tip in. But hey, and he has competitiveness in him. He comes to compete every night. Is it physical? No, but you don't have to be physical when you're 6'6 and 220. You just have to push guys anyhow, and he does. And he, obviously, he's a winner. And I can see he treats people around him when he comes back to Örnsköldsvik. There's a little town of 25,000 people in Sweden. He's very gentle. He is polite. He behaves, and he belongs. And thank you for letting him play in Tampa and enjoy himself.
Well, Anders, in 1976-77, you were able to score 50 goals in the first 50 games of that season. This is something that only a select few hockey players have ever done in the history of the sport. So did you know that you were getting close to number 50? And how were you able to get off to such a great start?
No, I didn't. No, I didn't know about any of the records, whatever. But remember, we had in Winnipeg, and I played with Bobby Hall and Ulf Nilsson. If we could have moved to New York, NHL, or whatever, you know, at that time, we would have done very well. We came to New York 78, and New York went to the finals. Ulf was actually injured most of the season, and he had been the best player, our best player. I wasn't very good. Our best player up to the point, he played about 60, 65 games. And we had a better team in Winnipeg than in New York that went to the finals. We couldn't say that at the time. That was impossible. But 70 or 50 goals in 50 games, no, I didn't have a clue. But when you are privileged to play with line mates and Lars-Erik Sjöberg behind us, and we played as a five, it was a pleasure. And it was pretty easy to score 50 goals with those line mates and those players around me and that team.
So after your NHL playing career, you became assistant general manager to the great legend, Craig Patrick.
Still lives in Pittsburgh, doesn't he?
I believe so, yeah.
Yeah, I think he does. I think he does.
Exactly.
So I just wanted to hear your thoughts on working from him, with him. Like, what did you learn from him? I know later on you went on to become a scout and GM of Sweden and a couple other positions in the hockey world. So what did you learn from Craig Patrick?
I only worked 1 year, and I retired at the age of 35. I was by far the oldest player on the team. And Craig asked me immediately if I wanted to join him as an assistant to him in New York. It was much smaller management at the time. He taught me, first of all, he came from a real hockey family. He had sort of grown up with hockey, parents, grandparents, uncles. How humble you have to be to survive and survive in connecting with people around the hockey world. So he taught me those values very early, and we got along terrific. Unfortunately, he got fired after 1 year, and when he got fired, I also sort of followed him along out the door in New York. And then I went back to Sweden and managed the first manager for a Swedish elite club here in Sweden. And after But one year, Craig got the job in Pittsburgh. He calls me and say, Anders, I want you to come over. I want you to be my assistant in Pittsburgh. I said, I just moved to Sweden. I just settled down my family. Craig, I'm sorry. I can't make it because I have to sort of had three kids at a time, all born in New York. They had started school, you know, and the, all those type of things. So, but he, to answer your question, he taught me more than anything else to be open-minded and humble in front of the fans, in front of the players that you were scouting, and not the least, the players that you had on your team, and make it a real team.
We're all good.
We just did a list of the top five European players, but who would you put as your top three Swedish-born players?
My top three would be, the first one would be Niklas Lidström. Not because of his personality, but the way he played, it was no physique, but you couldn't beat him. He was won two or three Stanley Cups in Detroit. He played for 15, 20 years. He was Norris Trophy six or seven times during his career. He is my number one. Not in personality, and he wouldn't be considered number one, I don't think, in Sweden. But for me, he is the number one. The number two is probably Matt Sundin. I probably wasn't as good player. Peter Forsberg was a better player at his absolutely peak. But Peter had a sort of a shorter career, and it was ups and downs. He was injured. At Peter's best, Peter would be my number two. But over a career from start to finish, Matt Sundin had a longer career. He was the captain of the team. He was a leader of his team in Toronto. So I would pick Matt Sundin as number two in terms of impact on one particular game or one particular season. The best level of them all would be Peter Forsberg. But as I said before, he because of the injuries, he didn't deliver because he was injured and only played maybe three full seasons. Otherwise, it was injuries interrupting his game and his play. And therefore, I have to make one more because there's four sort of Swedes that would be considered better than anybody else. And there's Boreas Alving in Toronto. He played for a long, long time. It was no question that he was competing. They loved him in Toronto. Toronto was also sort of a media hub of hockey in many ways. But those players I mentioned, not only three, those are the four major, major Swedish players.
Okay. Anders, what was it like for you to become the general manager for the Swedish national team, calling the shots for the team that represented your country?
At the time, I had been assistant manager in Toronto. I had been assistant to the manager in New York. I had been manager for a Swedish elite team. I had accepted the job, but not publicized the job in Sweden to become the general manager. And Glenn Sather, that I had known from the WHA time, called me and said, Anders, I'm going to New York. I need an assistant. And I'm saying, Glenn, give me two or three days. I have to think this over because I've just accepted, not public, but I accepted to become the manager in Sweden. So it was actually, it was a short-term opportunity. I just wanted to do it. I love hockey. And Swedish hockey is fine. And at the time, they needed somebody they had played a very conservative wait in the middle of the ice, no forechecking, don't make any mistakes type style for 10 years. So Swedish hockey was really going the wrong direction. And I almost took that upon, I have to change the thinking. I mean, hockey is a game of intensity. A game, hockey is a game of creating chances by other mistakes. Don't wait for the others to make the mistakes. Create chances. So that way, it was a fun job opportunity that I couldn't resist. But I only said, I'm only going to do it for 2 years, and that's what I did. And then I went back to North America and went to Ottawa, actually.
So we'll get you out of here with this tonight. I want you to tell me about the 1979 Challenge Cup, NHL versus the Russian national team. I mean, tell me a little bit about that series. And it was kind of, wasn't as much of a bloodbath as the Summit Series, but, there was still a lot going on.
Yeah, I can hardly remember. It was in New York, and it was a strange setup. The Soviet Union or the CCP had probably prepared for a month before these games, and here the NHL is putting a group together. They select you come in 2 days before first game, no preparation, no thinking, no philosophy. How the hell are you going to play? We all came from different environments, and the Canada US team or the NHL team won one game out of three. Didn't we lose the one game badly?
I believe so. Yeah.
So it wasn't a very good experience, I have to admit. Not at all. But at the same time, it was a really fun experience because this was our first year in New York. We were able to meet a lot of other players in the National Hockey League that had no connection with, didn't know at all. So suddenly you're sort of invited into the best room of the players in the NHL. And at that time, the NHL was, the WHA was gone, so now it was only one league.
Well, thank you so much. Anders Hedberg, join us tonight. Hockey legend. Appreciate that a lot. Thank you. And go ahead.
Yeah, no, it's my pleasure. Here I'm sitting, and this is a wonderful world, and you represent sort of a grassroots of hockey from North America, and I'm sitting in Stockholm, and hockey is incredibly important. But today I have to say there's one more issue that is much more important than the hockey, who's winning, who's losing. That's the situation in Ukraine. And let me explain why, because Sweden, just like Canada and United States, are democratic, human rights, the courts are working, and the possible changes if Russia, in this case, and Putin, not Russia, it's Putin, are able to overrun a potential democracy as Ukraine with 40 million people, that would be unbelievable severe consequences for you, me, my children, my grandchildren, for hockey and the world. So let's put our little show here in perspective. That really matters today is what's going on in Ukraine. Absolutely. So thank you very much, Mr. Biden, for supporting Ukraine as well as you do. That is very much appreciated for us Europeans.
Well, remind everybody, hit that subscribe button on whatever platform you're listening on. We'll see you next time. Thank you for watching. Have a great night.